Good morning, my name's Tabitha Jackson, and I'm the director of the documentary film program at Sundance Institute. And I'm here with a delegation of Sundance storytellers and filmmakers, and we're having an incredible time. So thank you for having us. I'm gonna put my cup down here. I have the privilege and delight to moderate this session. And as a moderator, I've been given some notes. Please inform the audience of the following. Please silence your cell phones. Please. Please wait for the microphone before speaking. We are filming the session, and so if you're here with someone you shouldn't be, you might want to rearrange your seating a bit. I love the idea of coming to Skoll, the World Forum, for an illicit weekend, but one never knows, these social entrepreneurs. After the session, please take a few seconds to complete a session survey and hand it to the steward at the back of the room. Now, I know metrics are important, but can I see the survey? This is quite, okay. Your feedback will help us make the forum better. I'm sure that's true, but this is quite brutal. So you're going to be grading us as we're doing it.
Oh.
Session overall, okay. Speaker quality,
oh.
That's you guys. Moderator quality, really? Please be nice. And as my grandmother said, if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all. Thank you. It will affect my pay grade. My boss is right there as well, so no pressure. I'm very excited about this panel with this array of lovely speakers. We have a panel that is really too big to be a panel. So the way we're going to do this is a little like a novel, I suppose. We'll have a little prologue, and then we'll have three chapters, and perhaps an epilogue. We were up very late, the Sundance Storytellers, talking about empathy, and talking about whether empathy is either a necessary or a sufficient condition for making change. And it was really interesting because we have different opinions about it. And in a way, it was triggered by the neuroscience panel yesterday, which I missed, but sounds absolutely fascinating. I come to storytelling and documentary because I think empathy is one of the most powerful emotions. And I think it is a useful device for change making. But some people don't, and some people feel that it's not enough. I think the discussion was about the limits of empathy yesterday. But I think in art and storytelling, imagination, which is a kind of empathy, I think, is non-negotiable. And so what we want to explore today with a range of filmmakers and storytellers and change makers is what kind of tools we have to think about change. And instead of me rambling on, I wanted to bring up, to kind of set the tone for this panel, a quintessential artist, just to frame what we might be doing today. So would you welcome Lynette Wallworth?
So yesterday there was a Sundance panel that I missed in the afternoon, and people were asked to answer the question, why I do what I do. Some of you were there. Why I do what I do is partly because of the painting that you're going to see here. So if you don't know this, this is Bruegel, Fall of Icarus. You'll know the Icarus story. It's this painting and it's this poem. Poem Auden wrote when seeing this painting in Brussels. And Tabitha's going to read part of that poem now.
About suffering, they were never wrong, the old masters. How well they understood its human position, how it takes place while someone else is eating or opening a window or just walking dully along. In Bruegel's Icarus, for instance, how everything turns away quite leisurely from the disaster. The ploughman may have heard the splash, the forsaken cry, but for him, it was not an important failure. The sun shone as it had to on the white legs disappearing into the green water. And the expensive, delicate ship that must have seen something amazing, a boy falling out of the sky, had somewhere to get to and sailed calmly on.
So I saw this painting when I was 14. I read the poem when I was 15 and I memorized it. I went to art school and I became a painter. I studied for 3 years. Tabitha has forbidden me from showing you every sketch I did from age 13 onward to now in my keynote presentation, but I can show you after if you want. The truth is that it compels me, that poem and this painting. The thing is, we live in a world like this, but more intensely now, where it's very hard to draw anyone's attention to the most important thing that's just happened. And this painting, if you know the story of Icarus, Icarus and the Adulis were trapped in Crete and were trying to escape Crete. And in order to try and escape, Diadulis built wings for his son, and in their fleeing, the son fell into the water. This is a refugee story. And there are those tiny legs that no one's noticing. That's the state of our world. How do we call attention to the most important thing that's just happened? That's what I think we as artists and filmmakers and singers,
singers is fine.
That's what we are trying to do. The thing is, the poem is also saying, some people did see. It's not just drawing attention. The ploughman may have seen. Auden says the ship saw. Auden says, the ship must have seen something amazing, a boy falling out of the sky. But this expensive, delicate ship had somewhere to go. There are two things there that call me as an artist. How to draw attention to the thing that matters that no one's looking at. And then, how to draw attention and change feeling from the person who saw that thing and doesn't care. The last line of the poem says, the ship sailed calmly on. My life is driven by the hope to change someone who is knowing tragedy is occurring, to shift from a state of being calm about it, to shift from a state of being able to just sail by. And the tools that we all use are driven by the hope to shift that emotion to something that is true feeling in response to a disaster that no one's noticing. And we use those different tools in order to shift from calmness to an emotion that hopefully will change the world. Thank so you. That's where we begin. Thank you.
Okay, so that was a beautiful prologue. Thank you, Lynette. So our first chapter, I would like to bring up some amazing people, these three people. Would you like to take a seat? Yes? No. Right. Do you want to go in the middle? Yeah, lovely. So, firstly, if I may, I'd like to start with you, Gary, Dr. Gary Gottlieb. Within the framing that we've that we've just heard about, you know, the moral imagination. How do you make change? How do you get people to not just look but really see things? Your background is in psychiatry, is that right?
It is.
So what, as Lynette was talking, what was going through your mind?
What was going through my mind was the combination of your comments and hers. In psychiatry, we like to say that the most powerful tool we have is accurate empathy. Empathy that truly fits with the need of whomever it is that we're working with what their strengths and what their weaknesses are, in a way that nurtures, in a way that empowers, in a way that understands where the ill is and is never infantilizing, but provides what is necessary in order to improve the human condition. I think to some extent what drew me to this work, other than falling in love with Paul Farmer 20 years ago, and in the work that we had done together in my previous work, was seeing in a consistent way what was seen in that magnificent painting. And that is that in an ongoing way, there is an emergency everywhere. There is that pain everywhere. And that there is the possibility of solution that's constant and consistent. I had the privilege of working in one of the most sophisticated healthcare systems in the world with what felt like endless resources, perhaps not when we're doing a budget, but in an ongoing way, and also touching the work of Partners in Health for most of that time. And through eyes like Paul's and Ophelia's and Jim Kim's, to understand that whatever was possible in the place in which I operated must be possible for everyone in the world, without exception. I thought about it as I looked at those frightened legs sitting so lonely in the water. The last year, in which I've been at Partners in Health and having the privilege of meeting spectacular people in Liberia and Sierra Leone and in Haiti and Lesotho and in Malawi and in Rwanda, in the Navajo Nation and in Chiapas, Mexico, and each one of them seeing genius and brilliance, seeing the same love for their children and the same hope that they had at their birth that I had for mine, the same expectation that their spouse would survive childbirth that I had for mine when we had our children, and that experience not being their expectation, but that hope being essentially what they deserved. And so the notion is that Partners in Health provides the potential constantly for that option, and that is the pathway to more accurate empathy in providing and empowering those people with their tools and their strengths to be able to find those solutions. The challenge here is that what we see in that painting feels acute, and the acute is chronic, and the disparity is grotesque because of its chronicity and its persistence, and that socializes us to its acceptance. And to some extent, we lose our way in regard to empathy. And the response is to otherwise become paternalistic. And that's a failure.
And I think, you know, some of what I have found so stimulating this week is, you know, people like Brian Stevenson, the way you just spoke, is about, and I think this is something that the arts can do as well, is enable people to look at things they don't want to look at, and to someone used this expression, to lean into discomfort. Because as soon as you start feeling the reality of a situation, there's an impulse which is very difficult to resist. I just as you were speaking, it reminded me of your mission statement, Partners in Health mission statement, which I just read this morning. And I think it's wonderful. It says, our mission is to provide a preferential option for the poor in healthcare, by establishing long-term relationships with sister organizations based in settings of poverty. Partners in Health strives to achieve two overarching goals: to bring the benefits of modern medical science to those most in need of them, and to serve as an antidote to despair. We draw on the resources of the world's leading medical and academic institutions and on the lived experience of the world's poorest and sickest communities. At its root, our mission is both medical and moral. It is based on solidarity rather than charity alone. When our patients are ill and have no access to care, our team of health professionals, scholars, and activists will do whatever it takes to make them well, just as we would do if a member of our own families or we ourselves were ill. I just think that's such a beautifully written mission statement that isn't talking about supply chains. It's talking about us as people and our moral responsibility.
But remember, the supply chain is part of the empathy.
Oh no, you said supply chain.
Well, I mean, to walk into a country and find very few medicines, and the medicines that are available are those from the 1950s, is an outrage. It has nothing to do with what healthcare should be and what must be. And a preferential option for the poor is that the state of the art of medicine must be available to each and every person with the highest degree of effectiveness and efficiency, with thoughtfulness, but must be. And that's, I think, you know, when that mission statement drives us to do what's ever possible to be able to find that.
Thank you so much. So now is the time, I think, to bring, before I come to you, Paul, now is the time to bring in Cori Shepherd-Stern, who's a fantastic filmmaker and a great partner of ours in the Stories of Change partnership that we have here. Cori, I want to ask you about the film you are making and for you to set up a clip that we're about to see that you haven't seen yet and Gary hasn't seen. So you must be quite nervous because you're about to show your work to your, okay. But I don't mean to add to that pressure, but please go ahead.
So it's a clip from a feature documentary and I first pursued the story in 11 years ago is when we began talking about it. And then began shooting the film in 2010, and it's gone through. It's been a labor of love, truly. And so the clip that you're going to see, I don't want to give anything away because they're about to see it. But I will just give the filmmaker thing, which is it's not color corrected. The audio's off. It's raw. It really is. I mean, it really. We're still editing. We're in post on this, and it's a truncated version. We have had to pull things out because it was. They asked for a 2-minute clip, and the truth is, it's very hard for me to give 2 minutes of this film. I'm like, but you need to know this and this and this. So what I think is really important to know about this particular clip, it's it takes place during a crucial turning point in Partner in Health's evolution in Peru. And there are some patients that they focus on who had been, I remember this from SUNDANCE that I want people to know before you see it. You're going to hear from a patient and he's going to say that he's been on medication for multiple years and it's not working. He wasn't on medication through Partners in Health for multiple years and it wasn't working. He was on the wrong medication for his treatment through a government program that was very well-meaning, but there wasn't accurate empathy for what was actually going on with the patient. So I think that's
enough.
And
would you like them to see it on that monitor or would you like them to see it on the big monitor?
What would you like?
I just want to be empathic.
Okay.
I just want to be accurate.
Let's do this. That's good. I forgot there's a monitor here. Okay, let's be empathic.
So I wanted to, Paul, if I may come to you.
Can I have a minute?
No, I want to get you when you're raw. Can you talk to us about moral imagination in your work, given Icarus, given what you've just seen?
We know Icarus is one boy, and there are probably 500,000 new cases of this disease, new cases every year. Just 100,000 perhaps in China alone. And you know, there, if it's inconvenient and inaccurate, that means that these cases pile up. In southern Africa, where there's a lot of HIV, people with this disease often die very quickly. But for others, they linger for years going through useless, although fortunately a lot's changed in 20 years, useless and debilitating treatment with treatments that can't cure them. So, and, you know, hence our insistence on accurate empathy.
Can I just pick you up on one thing? Because it's really powerful and it relates to storytelling, which is the thing about it's one boy.
Yeah.
The thing that moves me most about that, in addition to Jim Kim being so moved, which is incredibly moving, ahead of the World Bank, it's extraordinary, that power. But it's because it's individualized, because we come to know a person, we come to know an individual person and realize that it's his life at stake. It's not data and it's not generalized tragedy. It's Melquiades. So how, when you think about how many people are going through what he went through, are you thinking about a number of individuals, or are you thinking about it in the bigger, there are hundreds of thousands of these people every day?
You know, I think that's something that we are shuttling between. And if you're a clinician, and I have the great good fortune of being the primary physician early on with these patients in the first years. And so there's no option to not know them as individual patients, nor would we wish for that. And that is the point of engagement, not just for storytellers and for audiences, but for physicians mm-hmm. and nurses. It's the people we know, for community health workers. So I mean, I don't dispute that this is the powerful way of engaging, like the Bruegel painting. A powerful way of engaging people is through narrative, through story. The shuttling back and forth to the big picture, mm-hmm. though, is critical, especially when you think about the concepts that you brought up, evoked so beautifully in your comments on the painting and the poem. It's about one boy, and the sentiments that are sparked by that, by this, by even Jim seeing, you know, this patient who hasn't seen for many years in the film. The sentiments sparked, it does, you know, there's pity, mercy, love, you know, horror, that all comes through. Those are unstable sentiments, even, you know, mercy. And so if you can link those unstable sentiments to pragmatic solidarity that does think about supply chains, laboratory capacity, mm-hmm. nursing capacity, that requires that shuttling between the large scale and the local, mm-hmm. the numbers, the millions of people who are suffering in this way, and the individual story. And it's a very difficult thing to do. But even in scientific disquisitions and medical articles, the nurses, doctors, and often others involved in those studies are themselves connecting through individual
yes.
stories.
And I think that, you know, that what has been so illuminating for me this week as well is this systems question that I relate very powerfully to the individual story. And in a way, if we see that Melquiades is now well, it's like, ah, oh, well, that's a relief. And yet if we forget how the system is wrong and that we forget to be angry because Melquiades is better now, then this thing is gonna carry on and on. So I was joking about the supply chain, but the link, as you say, between the systemic failure and the effect on the individual is absolutely intertwined. Cori, before we end this chapter all too soon, just what inspired you about the work? Why did you want to make this film?
I think I was trying to make sense of what I was seeing. I had escaped from American television. I was a TV producer, and I ended up in Nigeria in the early 2000s. As I joke, a drug mule. We were collecting drugs from our friends in West Hollywood who were finishing up their ARVs or switching, and we were taking them to doctors in Nigeria. And when I was there, I just saw that there were so few doctors and there was so much need, and I thought, oh my God, some of this stuff should be, I mean, you know, I'm a producer, like, you gotta fix this. Like, what's the problem, you know? And I basically started looking around for someone else who might be, you know, is there any press, you know, I'm not a doctor. And I read a paper that talked about, you know, training community health workers. And I was like, oh, no one there was talking about community health workers. I was like, this makes sense. You should be able to train all, there's a lot of people in Nigeria. And it was by this guy, Dr. Paul Farmer. I was like, oh, he seems pretty smart, you know? And so, says the girl who produced the Mariah Carey special, you know? And that's when, because people think, oh, you read Mountains Beyond Mountains. I was like, no, I read this other thing, you know. And that's when I was trying to make sense of what I was seeing and try to figure out, like, is anyone, how are we going to fix this, you know, because you got to fix things. And when we first started shooting the film in 2010, it was right in the terrible earthquake, right in the aftermath of the earthquake in Haiti. And I was living in Liberia at the time. And I was really trying to make sense of what I was seeing in Liberia, because it was just horrific. It was so post-conflict, everything was destroyed. There were just no, I mean, it was horrible. And I can remember being with Paul in one of our first conversations, I actually have it on film, where I'm like, I mean, here we are in the midst of the earthquake. It's one of the most traumatic times. I'm laughing because I'm laughing at myself. It was so awful. And yet I'm saying to Paul, are you going to go to Liberia? You really need to go to Liberia. And Paul's like I kind of got my hands full here. But
we're in Liberia.
Now we're in Liberia. And that is one of the most, to me, I was trying to make sense of, like, can someone please come? One of my dearest friends in Liberia died from MDR-TB. Mm-hmm. And I think now PIH has seen what I assume was MDR-TB. It was TB. But now what you guys are seeing of TB, I'm like, it is bad there, right?
Oh, it's ubiquitous.
Mm-hmm. And even just recently, I mean, when I think about my own arc, you know, having where we were then and like, and now they're the people that the really smart people, are there, and it's a huge thing for me. I mean, I don't remember what your original question was, but
doesn't even matter. Doesn't even matter. But I think what this conversation showed, and as we go through the next couple of chapters, then we'll open up for questions. So Paul and Gary will be back. But what this conversation shows, thank you, is how filmmakers and changemakers and storytellers are driven by the same things. They have different effects, but the combination of stories as powerful as that, that we can see and engage with and understand the work through story, is an incredible thing. And that's why it's so great for us to be allowed into the Skoll World Forum for this meeting. So, excuse me. So thank you so much, Paul. Thank you. Thank you, Gary. So I've asked Cori to stay up here because I want to bring up the star of our next chapter, who Cori is also involved with. So would you welcome Sunita Alizadeh. Take a seat. So Sunita, how old are you?
19.
Okay, so Sunita's 19, and just over a year ago, maybe, you wouldn't have been speaking English.
Oh, yeah.
So because I don't like to show off in these situations, and my diary is pretty good, but I've just asked Sunita.
Let's try it.
Let's not try it. But we'll speak in English for the purposes of this. But thank you for coming to
thank
do this.
Thank you for having me.
So I encountered Sunita when we were looking at a documentary that had been made about her called Sunita. It's an extraordinary story. It also happens to be your life. And in the film, I met Sunita as a refugee from Afghanistan, living in Iran. And the story is quite incredible. And the film is quite incredible, and it won both the audience prize and the jury award at Sundance this year, which is no mean feat. And since then, actually, your life has taken a quite extraordinary turn, but let's get to that in a moment. Let's first have a look at the trailer of the film, Sunita. When I first met you, you were the, as it were, you were the subject in a film. You were the main character in a film, and you were at the film festival. Since then, since January, you've become an artist and activist in your own right. So today, I want to talk to you as an artist. And if it wasn't clear from the trailer, Sunita was on the brink of being sold into child marriage, effectively. I don't want to give the film away because I really, really want you to watch it. It's incredibly powerful. So let's see where we get to and if any of this makes sense. So as an artist, you use music and you use rap to express your feelings. But as we're talking about the moral imagination, Is there an equivalent expression in Dari for the moral imagination? What would that be?
It could be takhayul akhlaqi, and
what does that mean?
That means, for me, means making a picture of better world.
Making a picture of a better world.
Yes,
that's the translation.
And making a picture of a better life, not mm-hmm. just only for yourself, mm-hmm. for others as well.
So that's the moral imagination. That's a great expression. Say it again in Dari.
تخيل اخلاقی.
Fantastic. So that's also a very powerful translation, because in the film, we see that one of the ways in which you escape your reality is through your dream book. And do you want to explain what that is, your dream book?
I have a map in my life to reach my goals. It's called dreams book. I put all my dreams in the dreams book, and then I can see what is my next step. And I have so many goals, and I want to remember them. I have to put them in the dreams book. And dreams book for me means I have to believe it, and I have to think about it, I have to speak about it, and then I have to work for it.
So let me just stop you there. You'll have seen an image of Sunita cutting out pictures and pasting them in. So that's the dream book. You kind of imagine the reality you want to see.
Yeah, at that moment I had a few fans, like they were all my friends, like five or six fans.
It's a start, yeah. And so then you posted your picture onto Rihanna's body, and you saw the crowd of people around you. Mm-hmm. And then we see in the trailer there, it cuts back to you singing into a spoon in front of your five fans.
And actually a few days ago, I had a performance at Lincoln Center for 3,000 people. And
so that dream became a reality.
Yeah.
So we talk about...
But she didn't have a spoon.
That's right, no spoons. So this imagining, you imagine something better and you dream, you talk about your dreams book. What was the, as you talk about child marriage, how does the imagination and the dreaming help you what you do now?
How it helped me?
Yeah. So we see you with a big crowd around your music, but you also, I think, managed to dream your way out of mm-hmm. your situation. Will you tell us a little bit about what your situation was?
So it was very hard because I didn't have any model to look at them and learn from them to what should I do to escape child marriage. But I made a model in my mind for myself to continue to have a picture of my own future. And I could see myself in the future out of that situation. And I believed it, and now I'm here.
This story is so, I mean, it's so rich, and it's so about this ability to imagine, and you do it in such a powerful way. But so you were in the position that, as is the culture, that your family needed some money because your brother was getting married, and so the normal thing to do would be to sell you into marriage to be able to afford your brother's marriage. Was this was presumably a thing that was happening around you as well? It was happening to your friends.
Yes, it is common in Afghanistan, and I lost some of my friends. They were younger than me, and now they are having babies. So I knew I will be one of them, but not at that age, 16, and it was common mm-hmm. for me to see that.
Mm-hmm. So what you did was to begin to use art, your music and your rap, to express something.
I was always looking for a way to share my feelings, mm-hmm. and first I tried pop music, but I couldn't fit all my words in pop music. It could be 20-minute song. And then I tried rap, and rap gave me more space to say more important, to share more important messages. And I wanted to tell first my story and the story of so many girls around me and all over the world. When I was in Iran, I thought it's happening just in Afghanistan and in Iran. But when I came to the US, I realized it's happening all over the world.
So let's talk about how you got to the US. You were in this situation, you were using your rap, and you made a rap video while you were in Iran, which is the images that you see of the Sunita with a barcode on her forehead and dressed as a bride. And you put that on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Cori, you happened to tell us what happened next.
I was procrastinating, as usual. And I was on Facebook
And I was on my friend Ellie, who's part of the like Muslim Women's Association of Yemen, I don't know, something like that, had posted it on her page. And I saw this video that was, I mean, I was, who is this person? Who is this kid? And it was in Dari, and it was, I mean, I was so blown away. And I used to be in, as I said, I produced for Mariah Carey. I was like, I was in teen television before. And I was like, oh my God, like, what is this? And I Googled her name, and I found that there was a trailer of this documentary. I was like, oh, someone's making a documentary about her. She's fine. You know, what is this? And it was a little clip where she talked about that she was going to be sold. And I was like, I'm sure she's fine now and in a Swiss boarding school or something, but I better just make sure. And so I reached out, tracked the filmmaker down, who's an amazing Iranian female filmmaker, and just said, hey, sure, everything's fine, but I just want to make sure if there's anything I could do. Is this kid okay? Did she get out of her situation? I said, I have some experience. I've worked with over the years, meeting kids in different places, extraordinary young artists who are former child slaves or child soldiers or in refugee camps, and they're just incredible creatives, and I've worked to get them out of where they are and get them into school. And they're kind of, I've never had my own kids. These are like my kids. And she said, no, she needs help. And so we worked to get her out and bring her. I said, would she be interested in education in the U.S. at an amazing school called Wasatch Academy? And there's a little story with that, which is so interesting that it's not in the movie, that I said the school, Wasatch Academy in Utah, they were just about to open in January of last year, a music conservatory that is exquisitely beautiful. And I was on my first Skype call with Sunita saying, you know, it's where she's learning about this educational opportunity. And I said, but it's not for sure. But I told them about the conservatory. I was like, it's not for sure. We have to get the final approval from the school, and we don't know. And she said, no, I'm going. It's going to happen. And I was like, how are you so sure? I mean, we've got visas. You're undocumented in Iran. We got to get you back to Afghanistan, get you a passport, get you a birth certificate, you know. And she's like, no, it's going to happen. Hold on. And I'd never heard of the Dream Book. I didn't know what that was. The movie, I didn't see the movie until, I mean, well after mm-hmm. she's in Utah. Mm-hmm. And she comes back on the screen on Skype with this book, and she opens it up. It's a notebook. The Dreams Book is a spiral bound notebook. Get one. And and in it is, I kid you not, an identical music conservatory.
What?
To the conservatory opening at Wasatch. Identical. I mean, I was like, she's like, this is where I'm going. And I'm like, yeah, okay. And then we joke, everything that's in that Dream Book, like, you don't, I'm like, you gotta change, you know, there's all kinds. Now she has, in the Dream Book, she has her, she didn't have a passport, she wanted ID, and it said, visa for all nations. And now she's had so much travel as an activist.
I should be careful.
Because she's been to all nations, she just wants to go to Utah and study geometry for a while.
So. That is, it's a powerful thing, that Dream Book. And you know, from going from, you know, an Afghan in Iran with no papers, in danger of being sold into marriage when you're, you know, which would have stopped you having any education. Now when I try and have a phone call with you to talk about this panel, you couldn't do it because you were at the White House talking to Joe Biden and the First Lady and John Kerry. So how about next week? No, because she's going to be in New York with Laura Bush and the First Lady of Afghanistan. So finally, I catch up with her last night. She couldn't come to dinner because she had to do her geometry homework.
She's an extraordinary student. You didn't go to school because you weren't allowed to go to school.
Yeah, it is my first time I'm in a real school, and I love Wasatch. I love Utah.
It is a literally one stoplight town, Mount Pleasant, and this school is extraordinary. There are kids from 37 nations there, and they've taken a lot of my young people from Liberia, and it's extraordinary. But she is in a very competitive prep school and doing amazing. She couldn't speak English last year. I mean,
so this is extraordinary. I think talking about the voice, one of the things that's so important is that you, and I think this is, Cori, what draws you as well, that you are using your own experience, using your own art, using your own experience to speak on behalf of people who don't have the platform that you now have, but it's an authentic voice. And to have that ability to communicate directly, I think is very important. And often it's the thing we miss as storytellers, that storytellers can go in and tell somebody else's story. And to use a kind of phrase that's very current at the moment, it's an extractive process. It's like taking pictures. We take stories and we bring them out and we go to Sundance. But to have you now as an artist, activist, telling your own story and telling the story of others like you is an extraordinary thing. And you did it through your own imagination. You imagined something better. And obviously there are systemic problems. It's not just the power of your imagination. But that is the Da Vinci phrase about do not be constrained by your present reality. And I think you're just a perfect example of that. So I'm going to let you sit down again. Thank you so much. The great news is that you will be able to hear Sunita performing at the closing plenary on Friday, so we can actually get to experience the art that we were talking about. So thank you so much. Okay, so the third chapter in our lovely novel, Lynette and Nicole, would you like to come back up again? So you will, anywhere you like, love, you will be aware, hopefully, of the work that Lynette and Nicole have collaborated on, called Collisions. You have cards on your desk that talk about it. And it's an extraordinary piece of virtual reality, which is a new platform that people are very excited about, which is a 360-degree filming. So if you put on a mask, you can move around. It feels as though you're moving around in a space, and there's a sense of presence and proximity, which people claim creates a heightened sense of empathy. Do you want to tell us a little about the work?
So about 4 years ago, I heard a story from Aboriginal elder in a remote part of Western Australia, and he had not told his story to anyone outside of his family for 70 years, but he wanted to share it. He saw an atomic test in the 1950s in the outback of Australia before he had contact with the West at all. So he's walking around living according to all the traditions of all the generations before him, and he sees this apparition. What he told me he saw is the whole reason this film exists. And I'm not going to tell you what that is, because I really want you to go and see it. But when I heard the story, I imagined Neri, that's his name, having a meeting with Oppenheimer, who created that technology. I thought, this meeting never existed, but I could create this meeting. And that's the scene you're about to see.
Great, let's have a look.
There is what we do not know. And then there is what we come to know.
He knew the world would not be the same. Few people laughed. Few people cried. Most people were silent. I remembered the line from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita. Vishnu is trying to persuade the prince that he should do his duty and impress him, takes on his multi-armed form and says, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." I suppose we all thought that one way or another.
That's just a hint. That is not the virtual reality experience. That's a representation of it. And so I really suggest you go and do it so that you can be in the space and feel the presence with Neri. But Nicole, you produced this piece. It was we're lucky enough to support it through Sundance and through the Stories of Change partnership. And you're a director in your own right. But if you could both talk for a moment about how you see moral imagination in this work, and is there a change that you want to affect? Why use this medium? What is it you want this to do? Or do you just want it to be an experience?
You should talk a little.
Okay, well, I mean, when this project came to me through Sundance, and I had the opportunity to speak with Lynette a couple of years ago here at the Skoll World Forum about this story, and it just stopped me in my tracks. I had that experience. I remember very clearly sitting at dinner, and she told me this story, and I thought, "My God, it's such a parable for so many things about our time." And it's, as Lynette has said, it's something that that no one ever knew. It would have been completely forgotten, just like Icarus. And that's what's so extraordinary about it. So. All of a sudden in July, many things aligned in terms of virtual reality becoming a technology that where it was possible to tell a story like this in the way that Lynette did. And Lynette had a relationship with the World Economic Forum at Davos. So there suddenly became this extraordinary opportunity to bring that story to that audience at Davos. But it had to be done very quickly and with a technology that was completely kind of untried and tested. So we had to kind of push the technology further than it had been pushed before and mobilize everything very quickly. And I think the urgency around it was just, this is not the kind of story that normally gets told in that kind of audience. And it's a story that has the power to really shift people's thinking about an issue. And I think that that has been, for me, I've made verite documentaries and social issue documentaries, which are a very powerful medium as well. Mm-hmm. But I'm so struck always by Lynette's work and how I almost think of these things, they're like kind of devastatingly simple and devastatingly powerful concepts that, and almost, it's almost magical what she conjures. And it's such a different way to impact people. So to mm-hmm. be able to bring the story and Neri to Davos was I think in itself an incredible act of moral imagination that mm-hmm. she had, and I just felt privileged to be able to be part of it.
And Neri himself went to Davos, which is incredible. Tell us a little about that experience.
So it's well, to track back a little bit, I a couple of years ago showed a work about coral reefs and climate change at the World Economic Forum event in China. And that work had this incredible impact to the confusion, I would say, of a lot of people at the World Economic Forum, because it was a non-narrated experience of lying down in a dome and just looking at coral reefs shot at night. And the emotional, so they were fearful that no one might want to have that experience, that people would feel it to be a waste of their time. There was nothing really being told to them. And then people started lining up 40 minutes beforehand to make sure they could get in to the event. So that kind of change, I guess, or experience of what something that works through a different channel, the channel of emotion, and how that can open up another thought is what I'm interested in. So then the World Economic Forum and I began to have much more, I guess, you know, we now have a relationship which, you know, I would never have imagined 10 years ago that I would put my work there or want to put my work there. But the World Economic Forum asked me then to bring a work for their audience. So this works first audience were heads of state and heads of industry at the World Economic Forum, and I knew that would be the case. So when I was looking at that footage and that meeting, I was hoping that a seed would be inside the minds of that audience to see and identify and imagine themselves as someone who at a time was called upon to make a decision that seemed the most urgent thing at the time and afterwards lives with the regret of some of the unintended or unknown consequences and ramifications of the pressure of that moment in time. Nyeri speaks from a position which is always multilineal, multigenerational. So he left Australia for the first time. He came to Davos, and that might seem so incredibly odd. He'd never even left Western Australia, but his whole life he imagined talking to those politicians. From his remote location, 2,000 kilometers northeast of Perth, when I showed him pictures of Davos and Clinton and Kofi Annan, he went, yeah, that's the place I'm going.
It's like Sunita.
Yeah. So when he was standing there wearing many, many layers of puffy jackets, he was completely comfortable. But he had something he wanted to impart. And I guess those two things for me go together. One is the thought that allows us as artists to imagine, and the belief in that makes us as artists intent on trying to seed a thought through a means, whatever is our means. And in that room, to those people, after every screening, if Nyeri was there, he spoke, and if he wasn't there, I spoke. And I would say, if he was here, he would say to you, tomorrow when you're sitting around a table with people trying to make a decision about the thing that seems the most crucial thing at this moment, the Madhu would ask you, who is the voice at that table for the child who was born today? That was, I think, what he brought to Davos.
Yes.
He wasn't so interested in Sundance. But he loved, that was his audience.
Yeah. Speaking of audiences, I want to open up to questions. So start thinking. Just, Lynette, give us a sense of that this is a room full of social entrepreneurs who want to know, okay, that this art is very lovely and we too are creative, but what about the change piece? Is empathy enough? Is it a sufficient or a necessary condition? Did that piece actually make any difference?
Well, I feel like that's really why I wanted to work with Nicole, because I know she knows how to think about the long tail of this work. I don't think it's my forte in any way at all. Over and over again, I have been able to place things in a space and understand, oh, that has impact. But I totally agree, empathy is not enough, because empathy has to lead to action. I think I have the skills to open hearts. But once that happens, then this information, or what is the change, is the thing that needs to happen. And really, Nicole could answer that much better than I can about where now onwards this work is going to go. But the thing we're most proud of, I think, is Vienna.
Yeah. And that's a great, actually, example of, I think, how this kind of work can move towards change. There was a woman, Angela Kane, who is at the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty Organization in Vienna, and her husband saw the film at Davos and said, you have to see this. And she came up later and she said, all the hairs on my arm are standing up, and people have to see this. So we're going to be there for a week during their meeting, the signatory meeting that they're having, where they're bringing all the foreign ministers in to try to force the countries who've signed but haven't yet ratified the test ban treaty to sign. Wow. And they plan to show this to them right before the meeting. So that's just an extraordinary kind of ability to use empathy, I think, to move towards impact.
And because people can know a thing, but they can't necessarily imagine what it's like. The power of your work to to unlock that moral imagination. That's a fantastic example. So let us go to questions on anything or insights. Yes, the lady here.
Hi, my name is Patricia Marquez and I come from the University of San Diego. My question to you is, I have no doubt empathy is a starting point. I have no doubt that your work is really fostering that moral imagination. My question is, you know, what are some of the things that need to happen to mainstream that, you know, growth of a moral imagination? I mean, I think in places like the United States, among youth, I inhabit that world called carpool with teenagers. And I talk to myself about refugee crisis, about what's happening in my own country of origin. So what are some of the things that need to happen? You seem to have made a split in some ways about your life in teen TV as opposed to what you do now. What is the bridge that needs to be built so these teenagers who are not even thinking about what's happening politically in a country like the United States begin to think and engage and develop, you know, that moral imagination?
Thank you so much. And just to be aware, these questions are for all of you. We can sit here, but just anyone feel free to answer. And we're going to take a few questions to get through. But yes, let's have a go at this one first. Any of you?
I'll speak. Mm-hmm. I live in San Diego too. Hi, we might be neighbors. In terms of like making the split, I actually feel like I've been so inspired just by the work of like Partners in Health. And while it's not, I mean, there are a lot of teenagers who are fans of Mountains Beyond Mountains, for instance, the book. And then, but it's primary, you know, it's really hits college kids. I mean, I'll speak about Tracy Kidder's book, which is, you know, because my film hasn't come out yet, but that book, this piece of art, was then assigned to how many colleges? I mean, Paul, you've spoken at thousands of places by now. Like, so, it's required reading for so many freshmen. And there's this entire movement, youth movement, that I really feel like Partners in Health is at the forefront of it's gathering so much momentum. And as we, you know, I think to reach the youth, you have to reach the people who are with the youth. So I do think it's with, you know, through reaching parents and through reaching teachers and through reaching people who are there who can talk about, you know, what they see, what they know.
Thank you, Cori. Did you want to add anything, Gary?
Well, I think the connectedness that you showed in that clip between the image of doing the work and its actual effect on a human being told the story so brilliantly that a young person who sees it can see him or herself or him or her own friends in that transformation, I think becomes connected in a way that resonates a little bit differently than hearing a headline that's almost impenetrable. Mm-hmm. You know, Paul was talking about tuberculosis, which has almost no voice. So there are 1.5 million people dying a year, 500,000 new cases of MDR-TB. It's a horrible scourge that has no political voice, no policy voice, and remains a scourge that's completely fixable. If young people understand the connectedness between the individual case and the actual effect of treatment and the transformation, I think that narrative and that image has a power to it that can help to bring those young people to be the leaders of our voice as we move forward.
Thank you, Gary. I'm gonna get some more questions. Gentlemen at the back.
I think, too, exactly what Gary said. It's about telling the story of who Icarus is as a young man, who he is, who the person is. It's like Sunita.
Great. I have a question for Sunita. Since first meeting you at your premiere in Sundance, it's amazing what has occurred over these past few months. I mean, like, unbelievably amazing. Can you talk a little bit about, you've opened empathy. I mean, anybody who sees the film or spends time with you just is completely open. What can you talk a little bit about how you're taking that next step toward action? Some of what you are
doing. Sorry.
What you are doing in terms of taking the next step of action as an activist.
So last year, I tried to tell my story all over the world to let the world know about child marriage. And now I'm a little bit tired of telling my story. And I want to stop talking about it. And I want to do something. And my goal is to work with families, because I'm from Afghanistan, and I know what is the best way to solve this problem. So I think I'm going to work with families and to show them there are other possibilities. And then I want to work with religion leaders to get some help to change this tradition. And also, I want to work with laws to make child marriage legal all over the world. And I want to go to college, Harvard. Yeah.
Thank you. So yes, families, yes, religious leaders, yes, laws. Got to do your geometry homework first. Okay, another question. Yes, the lady here. Is there a mic? Yeah, yes.
Hi, I'm Maura O'Neill, and I was a serial entrepreneur, but then I was chief of staff in the U.S. Senate in 2008, and then chief innovation officer for USAID. And when I'm struck by this, and I was at Sundance for the first time this year, and saw Sunita, it's just an amazing experience, so life-changing. And what I'm struck by from your experience about Davos is how impactful this kind of filmmaking or artistry would be in Congress, and how yesterday the hearings are, etc. So this is more a suggestion or a plea that you actually work with some of the more progressive senators on both sides of the aisle in Congress and in the Senate to really bring this form of communication, because I think that that is what is just woefully missing in any of their decision making, and can't, and this kind of thing can't occur any other way except through art.
Thank you so much. Great. Another question. Yes, Howard.
And it's similar to your comment, is how do you convert the sentiment into political will? And you were talking about teenagers, you know, getting excited, but how do you harness that, or energized? How do you help them harness that to turn that into actual action and demands? That can be for anyone.
Well, yes.
To give an example, as Cori said, a lot of our moral support comes from young people. I mean, the mission statement that Tabitha read, we wrote when we were students, you know, and not off the cuff either, you know, really struggling with every single bit of it. And I think, you know, we're proud of it now, 30-something years later. But that's moral support. I would also say, you know, a group of Stanford students. Unfortunately, Sunita, Stanford beat Harvard on this one. You know, organized face aids. And it was really around a story, you know, the kind of thing that you'd grab onto, or Cori would. You know, it was a group of teenagers, back to Patricia's comment, group of teenagers from California who went to Zambia to work on AIDS programs to make, you know, beads. And of course, the women they were working with died. And then they came to talk to me, probably because of Kidder's book and not Women, Poverty, and AIDS, that great bestseller that I wrote. And, you know, and, you know, I said, well, of course they died. That's not accurate empathy. I mean, it's great to make beaded products, but they need antiretroviral therapy. That's the only treatment we've got. And they, as freshmen, they started a movement there, Face AIDS, to support Partners in Health's work to actually take the unstable sentiments of mercy, pity, sorrow, rage, and turn them into pragmatic solidarity. They raised, in the course of a decade, you know, $5-6 million across the country. And this spread from Stanford into Canada, across the United States. I mean, I'm just saying, you know, that's a very powerful example, and there are many, of young people taking this spark and linking it to something more stable that can actually save millions of lives and have.
Lynette, this is going to be the last word, so you can be profoundly, no, you can be artistically
profound. No, I just
was
going to say something not so profound. I was just going to say we started today with a painting I saw when I was 13 or 14 for me, education and giving tools to people who can then become the voice of these things, and not just the voice, the people who can then, according to their skills and their desire and their passion, follow the trail that will lead them to do that work. I happen to have the fortune of a very powerful teacher who encouraged me to be the person who I could be. I'm excited by virtual reality because I know young people are interested in it as a technology to place inside that a powerful story. I hope that there will be young people who will see that, who will then follow their passion to do their work. And I think that in a way we have to do this hopeful thing of seeding that next generation with these skills. And so a lot of our focus will be getting this work into schools.
So thank you so much. Thank you for an amazing panel. Collisions is showing, have a look at the cards, it's showing two more times. Take this card along with you. Please go and see it, even just to acquaint yourself with the technology. But it's a profound piece of work. Please don't mark down the panelists. You can mark down me in your surveys. Thank you so much for your attention.